Okay, so I have to redo my jokes. Bruce Hemming's giving away, he's giving away free tax receipts in the back of the foyer today. So, anyway, welcome to Lansing United Church. Thank you for being here this Sunday. This Sunday that we sort of think as ordinary time. We've moved out of Christmas, and we're still sort of in Epiphany. And this is the Sunday actually where Jesus starts his ministry. So it's a Sunday that I traditionally have always sort of had as a talking Sunday, because, you know, I put the question to us, what is our ministry going forward? What are we going to be doing? But it's kind of hard with YouTube because it leaves people at home then just sort of wondering where we've disappeared to. So so I'll have to figure that out for another year. But we will do some thinking. And actually, last week with Jesse here, we will be taking off from where he left off. And he actually had donated or gifted us a book called The Harmony Tree. And it really fits in with worship this Sunday as well. So we'll be using it. And we're kind of excited to have that opportunity. And this morning we also recognize and honor the Lunar New Year. So, and give thanks for all the celebrations that will be going on throughout the world and in the city. And my understanding is to, it will be hard to get any takeout or anything today. So I think it will be fine. We'll be busy. So yeah, so welcome. Other announcements are printed pretty much in your bulletin for you to read. Cindy, there was a pop-up a week ago Saturday. It went well, I guess.
It went very well, and we're opening next Saturday from 10 to 1.
Next Saturday, 10 to 1. Thank you for that. So, just as an ongoing reminder to bring things in, the bin's there. If you need something picked up from your place, I can always come out and pick it up, and we can have a visit. You give me coffee, and I take your junk, and go through it before we give it to the Nearly New shop, and then you'll see me walking around, and yeah, something that you had. But thanks, Cindy. And we're looking at moving into some sort of regular schedule with Nearly New, so that's pretty exciting. The underwear, I reported that we had gathered certainly over 100 pairs of underwear. A lot of the adult men's and women's, it all went to the Willowdale Welcome Center. So it's the old utilities building north of Young. And it is a 79-bed co-ed shelter. So anyone that really lands there is pretty well just landing with the clothes on their back. And so just nice for them to have some things. And we're actually going to start doing a little bit of work with them as well. We've nearly new when we have surplus things, and just sort of working back and forth. And Rebecca and Cindy, we're working today with another group who help folks who are more marginalized if they're going for job interviews, helps to set them up with clothes for interviews and that kind of thing. So lots of exciting things as we move into the new year. The AGM is February 12th, the annual general meeting. And reports will be ready for you February 5th, and you can also get them online. And people sort of sometimes roll their eyes with annual meetings. I get quite excited about them because that's our time of the year that we roll out the red carpet to say, you know, this is what we did last year, and this is how we lived in community with one another. So I always find them kind of exciting, but so we'll see. So, and we're even trying to figure out if we can't do some soup or something right after down in the chapel as well. So we'll just keep you posted. If there's no other announcements, then I will share with you our land acknowledgement. As we gather together, we acknowledge the sacred land. It's been the site of human activity for more than 15,000 years. This land is the territory of the Huron, Wendat, and Haudenosaunee, and most recently, the Mississaugas of the Credit. The traditional territory that Lansing United Church sits on falls under Treaty 13, an agreement between the Crown of England and the chiefs of the Mississauga of the Credit. Today, the meeting place of Toronto is still home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island. And we're grateful for this land that was under their care. And as a sign of our gratitude, we pledge to not only care for this land as a symbol of our desire to walk with Indigenous people, we walk in a spirit of reconciliation and respect. And we ensure that this is a place of inclusivity, a place of safety, a place where all are welcome, regardless of faith or race or sexuality or gender identity. This is a place where all are welcome. I just invite you, as we do, just to take a moment as we prepare for worship. I invite you to close your eyes if you're comfortable. Plant your feet on the ground. Feel that you are rooted in this place. And just take some time to breathe. Breathe in your sense of the world around you and give thanks. Breathe out those feelings of uncertainty in the ever-changing world. Breathe out any feelings of not knowing or understanding where you fit in. Breathe in the understanding that we all belong. There is a place for everyone at the table to share their unique gifts and be in community. Breathe out any pent-up stress that you're experiencing, as it feels like sometimes the world spins out of control. Breathe in the good news stories that sometimes we have to look hard for. Those stories that restore our faith in human kindness, in grace. Breathe in the reality that even in an imperfect world, God's grace is all around us, loving us and leading us in ways that hold us up. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. We light our candles, not just because I love candles, but we light them as a reminder. We light them as a reminder of God's presence, the Spirit that moves in and through our lives. We're reminded that we are an affirming congregation where all are welcome. We remember that we walk in solidarity with First Nations people. And we light this candle on this Sunday when Jesus begins his ministry by picking up four sailors on the side of the road. And he said, I will make you fishers of men. I will take you along with me, and I will help you to learn so that together we can change the world. And I don't know how many remember that hymn, I will make you fishers of men. But it certainly comes to mind. I will make you fishers of men, fishers of men, fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men if you follow me. If you follow me. Together. I will make you fishers of men, fishers of men, fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men if you follow me. Our Our opening prayer is printed for you in your bulletin. We'll say it together. God, we come to you from many different places in our faith journey. Guide us in ways of justice and compassion. Bless us with the ability and courage to be a voice for those unheard. Help us to be open and respectful of the ideas of others. Fill us with grace in the face of adversity. Give us the gift of lifelong learning so that we may continue to grow. Create in us the willingness to listen for your still, small voice that calls within each of us. Amen. And our opening hymn is number 562, Jesus Calls Us. Please stand as you're able and we'll sing together. Because his wife, Jo, is also trained in theology, and she's actually doing a master's at Emmanuel, where I went to school. And it's just nice to hear a different voice talking on about community and on that level as well. And we'll hopefully, sometime during this year, we'll get to hear Jo preach as well. And Jesse was kind enough to share with me his reflection from last week. And then he left this book for us in which to read. And it's dedicated by the fellow who wrote it to my grandchildren and to yours and to theirs. Not long ago, there lived a vast grove of ancient trees. The tops of their crowns reached so high that they tickled the clouds. Their branches stretched so wide that you had to spin around to see them all. The tips of their roots furrowed so deep that they touched the purest streams of underground water. Life in the great forest was happy. The ancient trees protected the young ones from growing too fast and provided plenty of food and shelter for many creatures. Everyone, from the rough grouse to the black bear to the white-tailed deer to the milk snake, lived in balance and harmony. But one day, without warning, everything changed. The trees heard a frightful, terrible noise. It was a noise unlike any they had heard before. It was loud, it was rough, it buzzed like a thousand wounded bumblebees. And then the noise did the unimaginable. One after one, the trees fell to the ground. First, it was the smaller ones. Their cries echoed throughout the forest. But the ancient trees could not stop the horrible sound. Soon after, the old trees were cut down too, falling quietly from the clouds and then crashing to the ground. The ancient ones fell and fell and fell until there was only one tree left standing. She was an ancient grandmother oak, and she did not know why she had been spared. Grandmother Oak waited for the terrible sound to come again. Day after day, she wondered when she would fall. Years went by, and Grandmother Oak's only comfort was remembering the years she shared with her friends and relatives from the ancient forest. All alone, Grandmother Oak longed for the grove to be filled again with young oak saplings. Each autumn, she would drop acorns from her branches. But when the seeds turned to young trees, the terrible noise returned, and the trees once again fell. After many years of trying, Grandmother Oak's acorns stopped falling to the ground. She felt like she was dying and no longer able to encourage new growth. Many long years passed before Grandmother Oak saw another tree. And then, one day, square houses started appearing, each surrounded by a fence, and strangely, to her surprise, trees suddenly appeared in front of each house. There was something odd and unfamiliar about these new trees. They were certainly vibrant and beautiful, but they looked different. They did not grow from seeds, as far as Grandmother Oak could tell. When they appeared, they were all well on their way to adulthood. And even though the new trees were so unusual, Grandmother Oak was thrilled to be able to talk to another tree again. "Welcome to your new home," she exclaimed. "New home," one of the trees replied. "This isn't our new home. We've been here for a long time." "Yes, this land has always been our home," said another tree. The new trees talked to each other about the old grandmother tree and how strange she seemed. Hurt by these words, Grandmother Oak became silent. The new trees grew fast. It was astonishing how quickly they shot up. But it was too fast. When storms came, they couldn't bend with the wind, and their branches often broke. Sometimes the young trees blew completely over because their roots were so shallow. When a tree was damaged, the other trees would wait anxiously. They had heard stories about what happened to injured trees, that they were always replaced with new ones. There was no time for a tree to heal. When clouds gathered and skies darkened, the new trees cried and wondered who would be the next to break. After watching in silence for years, Grandmother Oak decided to speak. "Friends, you need deeper roots to be strong." "Deeper roots?" asked one of the young trees. "How do we get deeper roots?" Grandmother Oak answered, "Tell me the stories that connect you to this land." The young trees thought to themselves. They were startled. Many had stories from faraway places. Some had stories that spoke of old and new lands, but none had stories that went far, far into this ground. None of them had stories of how this land came to be. Stories that told the power of this place, stories of how the Creator was behind making all of it. Eventually, a few of the trees became curious about the old oak tree. "Grandmother Oak, do you know stories of this land? Can you tell us what makes your roots so strong?" Grandmother Oak smiled and began to speak about the ancient forest she knew so well. She started with the recent past and those dark days when her friends and family fell to the terrible noise. The cries of those trees still a faint echo. And now that the new trees were listening, they too could hear them. Grandmother Oak then spoke of the happy days when her children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren surrounded her. All the way back to 12 tree generations, she shared about old trees that spent their mornings listening to the songbirds that landed on their branches. Flocks of passenger pigeons stopped on their way in migration to roost in the night. Herds of woodland buffalo and elk took turns grazing on the grasses that grew between them. Grandmother Oak recalled how the ivy-billed woodpecker dug for insects on her branches, and how golden eagles sat on her highest limbs. The young trees leaned in to listen and could almost feel their roots slowly reaching down to find new streams of water. They stretched a little taller as they heard tales of the ancient forest. Grandmother Oak's stories seemed as if they could go on forever, and they would have without interruption, but something happened. All the trees heard the faint sound together. A soft thump had hit the ground. "What was that?" asked one of the young trees. "Don't worry, friends," said a joyful Grandmother Oak. "One of my acorns just dropped to the earth." And they all smiled together as they thought about the seeds of new growth. Grandmother Oak's branches stretched out, tickling the clouds. She could feel a gurgle of sap bubbling inside her, reaching all the way from her strong roots to the tips of her tiny twigs. Cool nights and her changing colorful leaves told her that autumn was on its way, a time to rest, stand tall, and hope for the future of the whole forest once again. This is a story that we share on this particular Sunday because, again, as I mentioned, it's the beginning of Jesus' ministry. He finds the fishermen at the dock. He invites them to come along to start this new ministry. But, you know, and I think we're especially sensitive here at Lansing, that it's always a combination of the old stories and the new stories waiting to be told. And we need that combination of both as we invite new folks in, as we share our stories, and also listen to new stories that will be created as we go. Our prayer of confession is printed for you in the bulletin. We say this each week, just as our reminder to be humble, to acknowledge out loud that none of us are perfect, and we're all just trying to do the best we can. We'll say it in response. God, we aren't always open for your call.
Forgive us.
Sometimes we stick our head in the sand and try not to listen.
Forgive us.
Sometimes we'd rather fumble around in the dark rather than embracing the light. God, give us energy to look beyond the darkness. Give us the courage to listen for your call. Help us to carry one another when we need it. Amen. American writer Anne Lamott writes, "It's good to do uncomfortable things because it is weight training for life." In other words, it's good to push ourselves a little. Step out of our comfort zone, have new experiences. We're never too old to try new things. The whole story of Jesus meeting up with Peter and Andrew and James and John, the fishermen, is about them taking chances, giving up their old way of life and following Jesus. Now, we don't have to give up all of our things, and we don't have to give up all of our ways and traditions, but stepping out of what we're used to can sometimes be a good thing and helps us to grow and deepen our relationship with God, deepen our own roots with one another. Thanks be to God. I think Doug has that.
From Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 to 4. But there will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who live in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has shined. You have multiplied exaltation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you. As with joy at the harvest, as people exult at dividing thunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the wrong of their oppressor, you have broken is on the day of Midian. Words from our ancient scriptures.
Thanks, Doug. Doug, who's taller than me, so. Our next hymn is number 271, and it's printed for you in the bulletin. Please stand as you're able, and we'll sing together. There's a wideness in God's mercy. So that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. And from that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." And as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishing. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called out to them. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him as well. Jesus went throughout all Galilee, teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and the curing and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. And these are some of our ancient stories and reminders of the roots of our faith. So our roots run deep here at Lansing. Your roots run deep. They've been running deep for a long time. And as you, as a newcomer, you come and you get a sense of that. And the beauty, though, of a welcoming congregation is that all of a sudden you can feel like you can dig in as well and be part of the congregation and be part of the growth, be part of the changes. And they intertwine. And ultimately, they make the roots stronger. That is the piece of the story that we read that stood out most for me. The new young trees that had been planted at each house quite often couldn't stand up to the harsh winds because their roots hadn't been given the chance to grow deeply enough or be secured. They hadn't had time to fully latch on, hadn't become established. And as a result, then the high winds would take hold, loosen their roots, tear them up, pull them down, because they weren't strong enough yet. But at the same time, we have to start somewhere. And so our scripture reading is about that starting somewhere. Peter and James and Andrew starting with listening to Jesus' call somewhere in their journey, and taking a chance to drop their nets and look towards new opportunities and follow him. The new trees that started to listen to Grandmother Tree's stories, they started to deepen their roots as well. We all have different places where we start our faith, where we start our faith journey, and sometimes where we start it again. Because sometimes we do get uprooted, and it'll be times when you know, church isn't a priority right now, or there's those times in our lives where we can drift away, but it doesn't matter because you can always go back. God is always there. Jesus is always there. I wrote in, for those who don't get the news, the e-blast I wrote last week about, you know, just worshiping at Cherry Beach and being there and that solid reminder that if you have an opportunity, God's with us wherever we go. So, you know, to have that opportunity to do something different, to be outside, to worship in a different way, it's a luxury that all of us are given. And it doesn't mean that we're not where we're supposed to be. In the past, I've used this Sunday for table discussion to talk about ministry as a community of faith. But nevertheless, on this Sunday, we still ask that question. What is our ministry here at Lansing United Church? Are we here to serve? And if so, what does that mean? Are we here to recruit new followers? And if so, how do we do it? Are we here to simply share the good news? And if so, how are we doing it beyond Sunday morning? And most importantly, if we are doing any of these things, how are we continually finding new ways to do them? To be invitational, welcoming, share our own stories, be examples, give people new opportunities. That's what's exciting about church in 2023, the new opportunities that we have. We all go back and we remember the 70s and 80s with huge congregations and lots of people. And really that, we feel like it was our norm, but it really wasn't the norm. Church hadn't always been like that. That was sort of a blip in the long history of church. Church really has always been about having to work hard and reach out and be inclusive and do all of those things. It was a time in our lives, people were coming back from war, people were moving into new communities, and it was a lovely time, and we have many, many fond memories, but we can't use that as our benchmark to get down about what church looks like today. Church looks like being on the ground, finding out new things in our neighborhood. We find out new things in this neighborhood every day of how that we can help people and reach out and be in community. In the 70s, who would have ever thought we'd have three or four other congregations meeting at the same time? Or I've shared the story so much of our last Sunday of before Christmas, with us having our little lunch and the other folks having their little lunch. And you know, someday wouldn't it be wonderful just to have a big buffet out in the foyer with all the congregations, and we could just have lunch together? So those are the things that are exciting, because those are the things that we can work towards. Those are the things that Jesus would call us to do, I believe, in this particular time. In the Gospel of Luke, it's very much the same story as Matthew, and I actually prefer the Gospel of Luke for this story, because Jesus gets in the boat, and after they've already had a long night of fishing, he tells them to push out into deeper water. And he tells the disciples to drop their nets on the other side of the boat. And to their surprise, they catch lots of fish. That's called fishing from the other side. If one way isn't working, try another way. That's why we're here. Remember, I'm not sure if you remember, but a few years ago, there was actually a book called Fishing from the Other Side, about approaching church in new and creative ways. So as our annual meeting approaches, my own theme — I always like to have a theme for an annual meeting. And I can't help but think of the theme of taking church beyond the walls, continually seeking new ways. And it seems contradictory when, you know, you've done this whole revamping exercise, but by going beyond the walls, it just allows more people to have access to what you've created here. So it's kind of exciting, continually seeking ways that we can build on the amazing foundation of this place, and seeing where it can go, trying new things, paying attention a little more to what we're good at, and use it as a jumping off point for our ministry as we head into 2023, asking that question: what will it look like? It's about fishing from the other side of the boat. And if so, do we want them to come? And if we want folks to come, then how do we make it accessible and welcome? So maybe this year will be all about fishing for new relationships, new partners in the building, new opportunities, and being open to what those relationships will look like. We may be fishing for new ways to live with one another, live in community. Fishing for a more gentler, kind way of life. Not making committees so onerous that no one wants to help out, but rather making them not a life sentence, but something that people can participate and know they've been able to contribute, but not believe they have to spend the next 30 or 40 years in that position. It's about just offering one another grace and opportunity. Fishing for new ways of being and opening up to new opportunities. Now, Keith, and we're going to try a little video clip. Some of you will have seen this from the fall, and it's called Welcome Back to Church Sunday. And we just want to try it on the screen to see, as a test, to see if we can do it.
Here's a few reasons why people don't go to church.
I can't come to church until I get my life together.
Church is how I got my life together.
We always get one or the other. We'll get the sound or we'll get the pictures. As long as there's not a picture of me that shows up on there. That's why we're testing. I've decided that, you know, we might as well just sort of test these things as we go, rather than, you know, struggling, and, you know, we might as well struggle together.
Well, when it comes to fishing, patience is a virtue.
I know. Okay, sure. We will get to it, but this is just a great clip as a reminder, as a welcome back tool to church. And it's about increasing church presence, taking church beyond the traditional Sunday morning, an increased understanding of what church is in a visible and active way.
Why people don't go to church.
Full screen.
I can't come to church until I get my life together.
Church is how I got my life together.
Church is filled with a bunch of hypocrites. And there's always room for one more.
All they care about is your money.
They care about me, not about my money.
Dress code?
Yes, the code is wear some clothes. Church, it just makes me nervous.
I was nervous at first, and then I felt right at home.
I'm not sure I believe everything that you believe.
But you can still belong.
Church is for wimpy, girly men.
You want to say that again?
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't want me.
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't be worried.
You can come to my church even if you were brought up Catholic.
Baptist.
Methodist.
Jewish.
Mormon.
Lutheran. Pentecostal.
Presbyterian.
Church of Christ.
Southern Baptist.
A little bit of everything and a whole lot of nothing.
See, it's not about a religion. It's about a relationship.
So please, come to my church.
Where nobody's perfect.
Where beginners are welcome.
Where socks are optional.
But grace is required.
Where forgiveness is offered.
Where hope is alive.
And where it's okay to not be okay. Really.
There you go. I'm not sure if I'm crying because I'm so happy that it worked. But every time I see it, it touches another chord, you know? It really, it really is sometimes all of those fears that go through us at different points. So anyway, amen. Thank you. So our next hymn is Jesus, You Have Come to the Lake Shore. Please stand as you're able and sing together.
Thank you.
We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our Lord, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. And our offertory hymn is printed for you, but we'll sing it together. It's so much beyond the plate. It's about being at a certain time in our lives where sometimes we're able to offer more than we are at other times. It's about contributing in our own ways and being in community. And for all of those things that make everything work, those are the things that we give thanks for. Amen. And now we have our prayer prayed. Opportunity to come together. This opportunity to help examine our journey, our roots, and be willing to lay down new roots, and willing to be open to let new roots intertwine with us. Help us to listen for new calls, to be creative in our ministry, to be flexible so that our ministry speaks to people in 2023. You bless us with the ability to listen. So let it be. We give thanks for the roots that have been laid down before us from this congregation, honoring those who have gone before us. Help us to be creative and inquisitive and approach our new year with excitement. And now in the silence of our hearts, God, hear our prayers. God, we ask that you walk with those who are struggling with things that we have no idea about. Help us to be gentle with one another. We pray for those who struggle with mental illness, addictions, those who are just lonely, those without food, those without shelter, folks who are receiving extended care. We pray for them, the real people who are living through wars and the uncertainty of these times, persecution and poverty. Help all of our world leaders to lead with integrity and compassion. We ask that you bless this neighborhood and all of the people in it. Bless our young people who are here today and all of the young people in our lives, the little ones and the fully grown-up ones who are building lives of their own. Remind them that their parents and grandparents and great-grandparents and aunts and uncles have their back and are there to support them. We give thanks for them as our future leaders. And now we lift our voices up to you in the prayers untaught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we pardon those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Folks, our closing hymn is number 626, I Heard the Voice of Jesus. Please stand as you're able, and let's sing together. Out into the world, refreshed, replenished, and renewed. Lead us from here filled with a hope that knows no bounds. Instill in us a peace that can be shared with others. Empower us to embrace diversity and not be afraid of change. Keep our cynicism at bay, leaving us open to the mysteries of your love. Bless those we love and those we love. Keep all of us in your care. Amen. Folks, go from here knowing that you are loved unconditionally. Take the peace of Christ with you. Celebrate it. Take it beyond these doors. Take it to the street. Amen.
Thank you. Yeah. being our president.
We're all like 4 hours distance. Well, I won't keep you there. Thanks very much, man. We appreciate you.
I don't
want to leave this open. Next Friday, the last one.
See you around, Normal.
Okay, bye.
Yeah, that's for sure.
probably.